Let's start by reviewing the layout of evolutionary relationships among the different groups of plants, as we've described them so far, up to, but not including, the spermatophyta or seed plants. We're going to make a fresh tree from scratch. First, we have the Ordovician plant ancestor, the mother of all plants, which we'll call A, which splits into two groups. One of these retains the ancestral state of lacking stomata, and this is the one that leads to the marchantiophyta or liverworts. And the other evolves stomata, and this is the one that gave rise to the rest of plants. Now in the second lineage, we have a further splitting, and if we call the ancestor at this node B, one of the two lineages, the one going up, retains the primitive characteristic of determinate sporophytic growth, while this other one going downwards is going to evolve indeterminate growth of the sporophyte, and this is also the one that will give rise to the rest of plants. The lineage going up with determinate growth gives rise to the bryophyta or the mosses. And along the main lineage with indeterminate growth, we have a further splitting at node C, in which one, the one I've drawn growing up, retains the primitive state of having only a single sporangium on each sporophyte. And that's one that will give rise to the anthoceratophyta or the hornworts. And the other one evolves into the state of the polysporangiophyta. It's going to have multiple sporangia on each sporophyte, as well as a more extensive existence of the sporophytic generation. Now the polysporangiophyta, represented by all the offspring of ancestor D, is going to include a few early offshoots, like Cooksonia, in the plants of the Rhiney chert that I showed you in the previous video, as well as the main group of polysporangiophytes, which will be represented by all the evolutionary offspring of ancestor E, which is the basis of the eutracheophyta. E is for eutracheophyta. It's nice how that worked out. The split at E has one lineage of eutracheophyte, retaining the primitive characteristic of, well, not having true leaves. Euphyllophyte means true leaf plants. And most are all the lycophytes, which this is the lycophytina we're talking about, as well as all the other plants coming before, they had linear leaves without blade-like elements. Now the type of leaf that we normally think of as a leaf, called a megaphyll or a big leaf, evolved in the other lineage, or the euphyllophytina, which in this tree are going to be represented by all the evolutionary descendants from ancestor F. One of the two lineages emerging from F is the manilophyta, which is the ferns and the horsetails, and the other lineage is the one that eventually leads to seed plants, or the spermatophyta. And while it might be tempting to say that ancestor G is for gymnosperms, that wouldn't be right because the angiosperms are also in there. So instead we'll say that G is for spermatophyta, and maybe this lacks somewhat in catchiness or memorizability, but at least it's accurate. Now we know that went by pretty fast, but it really is just a replication of what we've been doing for the past lecture or two, and it also sets up this nice diagram which is going to help me out with the next bit of discussion. Now let's consider the method that we use to estimate when these lineages split apart from each other. Each of these nodes, or branching points in the tree, represents a single species, one out of millions on Earth at the time, that underwent speciation. A species split into two new species, and then each of those species gave rise to its own lineage. Each of these particular ancestors is especially significant because it's the reason, for example, that a species over here, a moss, is related to a species over here, a hornwort. It's the most recent common ancestor for the entire taxon. Draw the entire taxon like this. So this might be the entire taxon of the group we call the stomatophyta. They're united by this common ancestor here. Liverworts would not be in the taxon that's united by the common ancestor B. So given the significance of these ancestors, which I've named A, B, C, D, E, and F, it's a legitimate question to ask, in what periods of the Paleozoic did they exist? How old are these splits? Now the layout of the tree, who's related to whom more closely than these other guys over here, that's put together largely from morphological and molecular data. But our approach to questions of how long ago is largely going to rely on fossils. Now one thing to note here is we don't count. We can't count on having the fossils of these ancestors themselves. Fossilization is such a rare process that we have to accept the fact that the vast majority of species that have ever existed on planet Earth, including most or all of these important ancestral species, They left no fossil traces that could give us direct information on what these species were like or even when they existed. However, the fossils that we are lucky enough to have can provide us with some information, and here we're only looking for a latest possible date of origin for a given lineage. Take, for example, our eutracheophyte ancestor, E. What data are relevant for telling us about the timing of this ancestor? When did it exist? Well, since we can't actually look at a fossil of ancestor E directly, the best thing we can do is to take the absolute oldest good fossil of a eutracheophyte and say that ancestor E must come in sometime before that. The definitive fossil here must clearly be a eutracheophyte and not something like a rhiny plant, and we must also have good evidence supporting its age. In this particular case, it's Baragwanathia longifolia, and I showed you this picture last time. It looks very much like a lycophyte. Lycophytina are part of the eutracheophyta, and it comes from an Australian fossil site with an established dating to the Ludlow subdivision of the Silurian, some 423 to 427 million years ago. And now, with the Baragwanathia fossil, we can conclude with some confidence that the origin of the eutracheophyta, ancestor E, can be no later than this. Land plants first arose in the Ordovician, and one period later, some of them had already evolved into legitimate vascular plants. We're going to look next at the oldest known fossil of a seed plant. Its name is Elkinsia, and it comes from the late Devonian, and this sets the latest possible time for the existence of ancestor G, the first spermatophyte. But before going any further, there's one more general lesson in plant biology that's necessary for a proper discussion of seed plants, and this is the distinction between homospory and heterospory. Remember that homo means the same, and hetero means different. Homosporous plants have same spores. When the sporophytes undergo spore production, there's only one kind of spore that might grow into a male gametophyte that has only antheridia and will only produce sperm, and that's why we're calling it a male. Or it might grow into a female gametophyte that has only archegonia and will produce only eggs. Or it might grow into a gametophyte that has both archegonia and antheridia and is therefore a hermaphrodite. But irrespective of what sex of gametophyte actually grows out of the spore, the fact that it's only one type of spore produced by one type of sporangium is what makes this plant homosporous. Heterosporous plants have two distinct spore types, megaspores, and you might as well call these female spores because they grow into structures that can only make eggs. These megagametophytes, the thing that developed from the megaspores, are highly reduced in structure and usually contain only a single egg. This is the entire gametophytic generation, at least on the female side, and it's been reduced down to not much more than a sac for the egg. On the male side of things, we have the microspores, or male spores, which are the ones that develop into the microgametophytes that, believe it or not, are even more reduced than the megagametophytes. Now, you might think of pollen as plant sperm, but this is incorrect. Each pollen grain is a fully matured and multicellular microgametophyte, an adult plant, whose job it is to carry the sperm cell through the air via the wind or on the body of an animal and deliver the sperm to the megagametophyte, where it can then fertilize the megagametophyte's egg. One kind of spore, homospory. Two kinds of spores, mega and micro, heterospory. Now, part of being heterosporous requires that you make microspores that develop into microgametophytes, which we know as, what was it? Pollen. Good. And okay, so all seed plants are heterosporous, and all seed plants are going to produce pollen. Ferns, horsetails, lycophytes, they do not produce pollen, and they're clearly not seed plants. Now, some ferns are, however, heterosporous, not because of any closer relationship to seed plants, but because they evolved the characteristic of heterospory independently of seed plants. And this is something that's just going to happen. Just because you see that a character is present on two species does not mean that it's shared because of common ancestry. Because if that character had evolved twice, that is, separately on the two lineages leading to your two species, then it would be a mistake to count that character as evidence or some kind of indicator of recent common ancestry. So the problem comes back to our situation in the Devonian. We have what most consider to be the earliest good fossil of a seed plant, this thing called Elkinsia from the late Devonian. Let's draw the timeline for the Middle Paleozoic. This is the Silurian, lasting up until around 419 million years ago. And then the Devonian goes from that point up until the Carboniferous 359 million years ago. Elkinsia comes from the last part of the Devonian. Now, for obvious reasons, and I hope it's going to be obvious to you, it would be of great significance if someone found a fossil from any time earlier than this that's unequivocally belonging to the seed plants. So, if you were on a fossil hunt tomorrow and you found a very nice fossil from the Middle Devonian, how would you be able to tell if it's just another cool plant fossil or one that's of great significance because it pushes our timing for the origin of seed plants back by several millions of years? Well, this is exactly what happened. Philippe Jarion found fossils of a heterosporous plant named Runcaria from fossil beds that are 20 million years older than Elkinsia. So now the big question that must be asked is obviously, does Runcaria qualify as a true spermatophyte? And, good student that you are, you're no doubt saying to yourself that the only reasonable way to approach this is by establishing a list of qualifications, the synapomorphies of seed plants, to which Runcaria can either match up or not. This is exactly what Jarion did. We probably don't want to go through the entire list here, but I do want to point out a couple of items on this list that are genuinely useful in defining a seed plant for us today. The first thing that we see in all seed plants is at least one layer of integument protecting the megasporangium, which is where a single megaspore is produced that develops into a highly reduced megagametophyte. Okay? So this is a megasporangium. I've drawn it in blue, and it's protected by this layer of integument. Inside the megasporangium, you're going to start off with a megaspore that will ultimately develop into a multicellular gametophyte, which is made up of several cells, of which one cell is going to be the egg. Right? Now, the way I've drawn it is actually pretty accurate in the sense that even when the female gametophyte, even when the megagametophyte is done or fully mature, it's still no bigger than the original megaspore. A few cell divisions take place within the same confined space, and the adult gametophyte, this thing right here, is really just an egg sac with a few supporting cells. The second criterion given by Jarion was that this integumented megasporangium must be born on a cupule structure that stays attached to the sporophyte. Now, in contrast with something like a fern, where the gametophyte grows from a spore and does so independently of the sporophytic parent, and certainly not on any kind of cupule, in seed plants, the megagametophyte completes its development right there on the sporophytic parent's cupule. And this means that the sperm must be delivered to the cupule via pollen grain through the air. The zygote that results is what will develop into the next sporophytic generation, and it's going to be packaged together with a large mass of nutritive tissue, together with a protective outer seed coat. And this is the structural composition of the seed of all seed plants. Embryo, nutritive mass, seed coat. And then the seed must somehow disperse or get away from the mother plant to some new location to start a new life. We're going to be coming back to both of these seed plant characteristics in later discussions. So now getting back to our tree, let's move things over to the left. I've already moved them over so that we can put more detail on the spermatophytes. You remember ancestor F, the euphyllophytine that gave rise to one lineage over here, the manilophyta, ferns, and horsetails, and this other lineage is the one leading to seed plants. It may be one of the earliest offshoots, gives rise to Runcaria of the Middle Devonian, and then the later one gives rise to Elkinsia of the Upper Devonian, and this is followed by a succession of seed ferns of the Devonian Carboniferous all along the stem lineage that ultimately gives rise to modern seed plants. Now, Jarion decided in the end that Runcaria was not exactly qualified to be a true seed plant, and so that's why I put it in this tree below Ancestor G, while Elkinsia is a descendant of Ancestor G, so it's a legitimate seed plant. Now here's kind of a weird thing. We actually have to move farther out from G in order to get to the important ancestor H, which is going to be the most recent common ancestor of all living seed plants. Now there's a legacy of seed ferns and other plants from the Devonian and Carboniferous that are not part of the evolutionary family that encompasses all modern seed plants, which have exactly five taxa. Four of these are the gymnosperm phyla, Saghetophyta, Ginkophyta, Coniferophyta, your book might say Pinophyta, and the Nidophyta. And all these gymnosperms are more closely related to each other than they are to the fifth seed plant group, which is the angiospermy, also known as the flowering plants, which arises from a lineage that splits off by itself from ancestor H. Think of ancestor H as being the species that gave rise to all modern seed plants, both gymnosperms and angiosperms. Our four gymnosperm groups are more closely related to each other than they are to the flowering plants, and therefore they must share a common ancestor that's more recent relative to H. We'll call it ancestor I. Now, how long ago was the existence of ancestor I, which is the species that gave rise to ginkgos and pine trees and cycads, but not flowering plants? Well, the oldest known cycad fossil is from 318 million years ago, sort of middle to late Carboniferous, and so we conclude that the ancestor I would have had to have come sometime before that, maybe early to middle Carboniferous. Ancestor H, the one that gave rise to both gymnosperms and angiosperms, must have come sometime before that, and yet after the origin of seed plants, which based on the Elkinsia fossil we put in the late Devonian. But this brings up an interesting point. Why are we focusing on ancestor G, which must have been an obscure ancient plant, and it's not even the most recent common ancestor to any pair of organisms alive today? Ancestor H, on the other hand, is the real and true link between grapefruits and pine trees. So why aren't we trying to place an age on this far more important ancestor, H? Okay. Well, think about this. What kind of fossil would you need in order to determine a latest possible time of existence for ancestor H? Would, for example, a gymnosperm fossil do? Well, no, right? Because if you found a conifer fossil tomorrow that was older than 318 million years old, that would probably go a long way to affect our understanding of ancestor I. But that's not our target. In order to get at H, you would need to have a fossil of a non-gymnosperm from this lineage over here, the one that gives rise ultimately to the diversity of flowering plants. But fossils from along this lineage are non-existent, or at least we haven't found any. This whole lineage goes AWOL for about 180 million years until the Cretaceous, and we're going to spend some time on that problem in a future lesson. We're going to start the next lesson with a survey of these different kinds of gymnosperms. So to summarize what we've covered here, we started off with some basic tree analysis and what I think was a common sense discussion on how we can use fossils to determine the latest possible time of origin for a taxon. That is, at what point in the past did the most recent common ancestor for a given taxon exist? We also addressed the differences between Heterospory and Homospory, and in particular the way that Heterospory is a core concept at the base of what defines seed plants. Megaspores and megagametophytes and ovules and seeds, and microspores and microgametophytes and pollen, these are key features in the life cycle of all seed plants, and they're largely absent from the more basal plants and all the more ancient plants we've been talking about that came before the seed plants.